church, we love God. Make no mistake about that. At our church, we believe Jesus is God. We're not asking you to change your belief system before you attend our church. We're simply inviting you on a journey toward Jesus.
We believe that prayer moves the hand of God, and it's normal for every believer to be intimate with God and devoted to His cause. At our church, we believe the Bible is God's Word. It's real, it's living, and it's active. We believe freedom is the heart of God for every believer, and we value humor, simplicity, teamwork, and a positive outlook on life.
At our church, we're about developing great relationships with God, each other, and those in our community. At our church, we believe that Jesus really lived, that He really died on the cross, and that He really rose again on the third day. And we cannot and will not water down or candy coat that message, ever.
And finally, and most importantly, at our church, we're not concerned about where you've been, but where you're going. We believe that all people matter to God, and therefore matter to us.
Today, you have chosen to sit yourself in the middle of a very safe place to hear a potentially life-changing message. Welcome to our church.
Morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
How's everybody doing today? Good. Alrighty. Alrighty. Well, it was a rough week for me last week. A lot of stress. But I'm getting better day by day. And taught me a few things, too. But life's short, you know. Sometimes we think that we've got forever, but we don't. The scripture says every man will die. So I feel like that we're going to enter a new season, not only just in my life, but in the church of Bio. And I feel like that... God's got good things in store for us. Mm-hmm. We just got to keep persevering. I'm going to talk about that a little bit today. I'm going to go off the path of the verse by verse. I'm going to talk about Elijah a little bit and his doubt that he had. But let's open in prayer. Worship God. Amen?
Amen.
Father God, I want to thank you for today. I want to thank you, Lord, for the people that helped me through last week.
Yes.
Father, I want to ask that you touch me today, Holy Spirit, that your word would come out of me today, not mine, but I would allow you to work through me, God. Lord, I ask you to bless each and every one that helped in the service and ministered in the ways they could with my mom's burial. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Let's stand and give God praise. And if you have to sit down, then that's okay. We won't hold it.
Servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And though these are days of great trial, of famine and darkness and sore, still we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, He comes riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. Trumpet call, lift your voice. It's the year of Jubilee, and out of Zion till salvation comes. These are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. Your servant David rebuilding the temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest. The fields are as wide in your world. And we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, He
You are my refuge. touched me. And now I am no longer the same. He touched me. Oh, he touched me.
I will sing of the goodness of Then he said to them, "Go your way, eat the fat, drink the sweet, and send portions to those who mourn, and send portions for whom nothing is prepared. For this day is holy to the Lord, our Lord. Do not sorrow, for the joy of the Lord is your strength." And I think about mm-hmm. that. Thing. You know, no matter what happens to us in this life, mm-hmm. the joy of the Lord is our strength. Knowing that He's in charge, He'll take care of it. It's not the end. You know, we have bad things happen. We lose people we love. But when it's all said and done, we can still look to God and have hope.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
yes.
mm-hmm. Have hope no matter what happens. Someday, like Richard said at the funeral the other day, you know, all these sorrows and tears and pain is going to be gone.
Yeah. Yeah.
We're going to
Amen.
Spend eternity yeah. with each other. You
Amen.
Know,
yeah.
I a lot of times feel like I don't get the opportunity to really know each one of you the way I should because we're all busy, we all have work, we're all doing this and that and everything. You know what? We're going to have eternity. I've often thought of, you know, if we know somebody in California and we want to walk there to see them, we've got plenty of time to walk there and visit 2 or 3 days with each person we come in contact with. And we're still going to get there and see them and still have plenty of time, you know.
It's Something I never thought about, there's going to be snakes in heaven.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, said we're going to come back down and live on the, you know, come back down and live on the earth, the New Jerusalem, and all the people in it, we will rule over. So, you know, it's like, we're going to have time. Yeah. You know, we're going to have lots of time.
Amen. Roxanne, I just want to say we are so proud of our grandson, Brandon, for how far he's come. He's done remarkably well. And also, my son, he's doing really good. He's finally got himself turned around. And he's still living in Tennessee, but we're proud of him.
Well, praise God. Amen. It's a hard road.
Never give up.
That's right. Sometimes you fall, but you get back up and you move forward, you know. And, I'm proud of the ones that's working. I know I've been talking about and thinking about, pondered over starting a program, but I don't know if it would be here or someplace else. Because I've had more than one, probably about three or four people, and it's just been recently that's talked to me about it. So I'm like, well, maybe I better listen to God. It might be a little nudge in that area. So my husband is very good at working. We did life healing choices together with a bunch of
about a year.
He's real good at it, so I think that he would be involved with the men, and we just might, you know, we're still in the process of figuring out how we're going to do it, but I think it's this time coming from my heart and not doing it because I think I'm going to help somebody. It's coming from my heart that God will work in God's moment.
I have a question, Roxanne. Israel annexed the Golan Heights this last week. Is that significant in our prophecies, or has that got anything to,
you know? Say it again. I didn't.
They annexed the Golan Heights. Haven't heard anything about that.
I haven't seen the news. I guess I haven't watched it. I'll have to.
I was going to say, Steve, I don't know. I haven't really connected it with anything in the scripture, but you know, if you read what the Bible says, is the borders of Israel, I guess, is the thing.
Yeah.
Israel's never been that big. So, you know, it's when Israel, you know, at some point it will be that big. So, like I said,
yes.
You know, it's them taking up the Golan Heights back and everything. That doesn't surprise me, but.
Oh, they took it back?
Well, they claimed it as, you know, inside their borders.
They actually had won that during the 67 war, say, fought Syria.
Yeah.
And
I would say it is, and if, yeah, I have to listen to the news and then get on the map and then get in the word to see, but if it's growing, then that's another come true prophecy, you know, that in the Bible, that, you know, we're living in the last days right now.
Yeah.
There's no doubt in my mind that it's going to be soon.
Yeah.
And we need to get our houses in order. We need to get our, you know, we need to be living for God and put Him first, and then telling others of His love. Not preaching at them, just telling them of His love. You know, God loves us so much, and that's something He's been teaching me lately. He told me that I'm learning His love. And we all have mindsets that we think we know somebody, or, you know, kind of judge people by certain things. And God doesn't do that. He loves us unconditionally. He loved us so much He died for us when yet we were but still sinners. And He went to that cross when we were in our mess. So that tells me, if He went to our cross, to the cross when we were still yet sinners, how much more would He have done for us as His loved ones that believed in Him, asking Him? How much more? We're His kids. We're His adopted kids. And yeah, you know, kids, what do kids do? They go out and do things they shouldn't do, right?
Yeah.
Is God still loving?
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Well, we're going to be in 1 Kings today. You know, I'm not sure how I'm going to do this because it goes into 19. But I want to talk a little bit about how do we overcome seasons of depression, you know. They seem to be a universal challenge for every woman. And oftentimes, in your response to circumstances or spiritual struggles, spiritual depression sets in. And what happens when spiritual depression sets in is that we forget who we are in God. We forget who we are, and we take our focus off of God, and we put it on me, our self, and that's a dangerous place to be. Because when we do that, we're not relying on God's strength to help us. We're relying on our own. And what does man do when man's got that self-pity motion thing going on and stuff? Man does what man used to always do. You know? So they struggle. When we doubt God's goodness and trustworthiness, just as Elijah did, because we're going to go into that story. Elijah was a great prophet of God, now wasn't he? Called down fire from heaven. He was a great prophet. Yet Elijah, he succumbed to self-pity. Despair set in. Many times I say despair, like we was talking about, earlier, just addiction-wise, when despair sets in, usually that's what happens. You go right back. So he got his eyes fixed on himself and the situation rather than on God and his promises. And Elijah believed that he was the only one left. Now, how many times do we in our lifetime feel like, I'm the only one that's going through this. Nobody understands. How many times we get like that? A lot. I know I do a lot. And that's because I'm alone too much. I'm alone too much. Get in my own head. You know why groups are so important? You know why it's so important to fellowship with other Christians? Because it keeps you strong. Mm-hmm. It keeps you strong. When you don't have that support of other Christians or other women who are Christians or other men who are Christians trying to walk the same walk that you are, it's too easy to fall down. And if that friend's not around to pick you up, you got a problem, right? Sometimes we believe we're the only ones going through the circumstances. And this requires us to do what the psalmist did in his state of mind and proclaim to your own soul the hope that you will hear God's voice again. Many times when that happens, we've got so much going on in our head with the situation or circumstance that we're going through, or we're so bound on ourselves that we can't hear God's voice, because his voice is a whisper. His voice is small, Scripture says. Small, still voice. So we've got so much junk going on that we can't hear him talk to us. And when we lose... when we lose hearing God's voice, we get caught. We got to cling to his truth of what his word says. We got to cling to his truth that his word says that who I am in him, right? So 1 Kings 19, 11 through 15, I think. So he said, go forth and stand on the mountain before the Lord. And behold, the Lord was passing by. And a great and strong wind was rending the mountains and breaking in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a sound of a gentle blowing. When Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his mantle or his shroud. And he went out and stood in the entrance of the cave. And behold, a voice came to him and said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" Okay. Then he said, "I have been very zealous for the Lord, God of hosts, for the sons of Israel have forsaken your covenant, torn down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword, and I alone am left, and they seek my life to take it away." Where was Elijah? You guys remember the story of Elijah? Well, here's a great prophet of God. He was a Tishbite. A great prophet of God who called down fire from heaven. Now what happened is he got in here with these Baal worshipers, and they were claiming to worship God, and he was like, "Well, who's the real God? Let's do something here. Let's build an altar, and let's both take a bowl, and let's cut it into pieces and put it on the altar." He goes, "And then we'll call down fire from heaven, and whoever's God comes down and burns that up, then that's the one true God." And they're like, "Okay, well," so they cry out, and they worship their Baal, and worship their Baal, and they dance around the altar, and they even had a custom of cutting themselves back then. So, you know how women cut, or men cut themselves to, that's nothing new. So they were cutting themselves, and they were bleeding all over the altar, and they were worshiping Baal, and they were calling down fire, and they did it all day, and half into the night. And what happened? Elijah's just like, "Yeah, okay. You done yet? You done now?" So Elijah, he's like, cuts up the bull, puts it on his altar. It's his turn now. And I like how he mocked when they were dancing around that altar and trying to praise Baal. I liked how he mocked them. He goes, "Well, maybe God's, maybe he's busy. Maybe he's asleep. Maybe he's relieving himself." And I thought that was kind of funny because, you know, in his own words, he was like liking their God just unto a human being, relieving himself. So when Elijah's turn came, he made a big, big to-do of it. He cut them pieces of that bowl, laid them on the altar, took 12 stones, and that represented God, Jehovah, his name, and the tribes. Built that altar up. And he said, "Dig a trench around this altar." So he digs this big old trench around the altar, enough to hold 3 gallons. And then he said, "Take them big urn gallon things and fill them up with water and dump it all over the meat and the wood and everything." Now what would happen if you did that? And you were going to call down fire and start that up and have a big barbecue. Now what would happen if you dumped water all over it? Got the wood wet.
It wouldn't burn,
right? So he not only did it once, he did it 3 times. He had them fill them water jugs up and pour it over the altar. Fill them up again and pour it over the altar. And the water came down. And then the water started going into the trench down below. And it was soaked to the bone. It would have took months before that wood would dry out to be dry enough to burn. But then here's Elijah. He calls fire down from heaven. Now, did he know who he was? He knew who he was then, didn't he? He knew that he was called of God and that he was a prophet of God. He knew that that's my dad, I'm his son, And he's going to do what I ask him to do. So he calls down the fire. And the word says that fire lit up. Lit up the sacrifice and all of the water around it. Now, how hot would that fire have to been to have done that? Now, I think of lightning coming down. Because that, you know, lightning's very, it's like an explosion when that would happen. But the thought that it just licked up all the water around it. And then he killed all of Baal's prophets. Everybody. 450. One man. Mighty man. How could one man do all that? He knew who he was in God. So here's, then he has this little snitch, see? Has this little snitch in chapter 19, I think it starts. Has this little snitch that goes back and he tells Jezebel. Oh, Jezebel, guess what happened? Elijah killed all of your prophets. Oh, that makes her mad. Makes her steaming mad. So she says, well, I want to send you this message. You tell him that I'm going to do to him everything he did to all of them, and then some. And then I'm going to chase him down. So the message gets back to Elijah. What's the message? It's just our word, right? Yeah. Our word. When we say a word, it's a prophecy, kind of. What we speak, we usually get. If you're going to speak negativity, it's going to come your way. If you're going to speak blessings and love and mercy and compassion, it's going to come to you. If you speak the other opposite, it's going to come to you. Our words are powerful. Powerful. So Jezebel sends that message to Elijah, and what's happened? Elijah forgets who he is because he hears a word that she's going to come get him and wipe him out. So he runs and he hides in a cave. He runs, a man, a prophet of God that killed 450 Baal worshiper prophets, was scared. He was scared. He was afraid just because of a word that was spoken to him. He forgot where he was at. He forgot he could call on his mighty God. He forgot and got caught up in his own self, his own self-pity. Oh, I'm the only one left. Nobody else is worshiping God. I'm the only one left. Nobody cares. Got off in the cave. And you know, I think I didn't understand what it says, the rocks fell and the wind blew, but the Lord wasn't in it. Can you imagine hearing all that? But he came out to the edge of the cave. Sometimes we got to do that in our own self, in our own soul. We got to come out to the edge of who we are. And listen. Before we can hear God speak, we got to look to Him and not to us. Are we compassionate? Are we really seeking God? Are we just sitting in the pews warming them? I mean, are we really hearing God's voice? Are you hearing His voice? Because He speaks all the time. Are we sitting and listening to Him? When He spoke to me, He was teaching me, He said, you're learning my love. I thought, you know, that's the first time, God, that I can remember that I've heard Him in a while. And I went, huh, because what I've been going through this last week, I would not put the two of those together at all. But see, sometimes we get so caught up in ourselves, things might happen, and we find out we're not who we thought we were. And maybe we're not as strong as we thought we were. And then you start to realize, you know, I've been leaning on myself. I haven't been leaning on God at all. Who
child of the Most High God. Lean on Him. He's your daddy. He's your Abba. He's your father. He's your love. He's your friend. Lean on Him. You know, at the end of our life, and I speak about this a lot, I'm so blessed that my brother and me both were there at my mother's side when she passed away. That is such a blessing, and I've asked God that over and over again to please allow us to be there or take her in her sleep, because I didn't want her to die alone. And when she took her last breath, my brother and I both were there. He blessed me by allowing me to have that promise from God. When we take our last breath, we might have our loved one over here. I mean, I pray my girls are by my side and my husband's by my side. I really want them there when I take my last breath. But the thing that matters the most, when our last breath comes, our focus should be, Jesus, take me.
Thank you, Lord.
I'm here. Because He is our living hope. He's our only hope in this world today. Jesus. And you know, I looked at a book down at the old bookstore downtown. You know, me and Mike went for a walk the other day, and I stopped in there and I was looking around. I seen this book that said Jesus Freaks on it. And I'm like, huh. I need to be a Jesus freak. I mean, you know, sometimes certain people that are real talk about the Lord all the time can get on your nerves a little bit.
Yeah.
But the thing of the matter is, what is important? It's God. It really is God. He's the only one that will help overcome the darkness of this world and this community. And there is always an evil spirit that is over every community. Every community. And the one that's over this one is narcotics and drugs and just darkness, witchcraft. That's what's over this community. I don't know if any of you guys know that, but that's what's over it. And the thing that we need to do as Christians is pray against that demonic spirit, that demonic evil force. Because we have mighty warrior angels out there.
Amen.
That all we have to do is call on them to come down and take charge and whip the crap out of the demonic spirits. Mm-hmm. Let me ask you a question. We all got grandkids probably that are into drugs or into alcohol or into witchcraft. Witchcraft's a big one in this community. Now, don't think so. I mean, you might think that nobody's dabbling in it, but chances are they are. We need to start praying. And I mean praying. Put that on your list. Make it a priority. I mean, Steve was given a testimony this morning about his daughter. She was in prison. She had went through a life that wasn't a good life, but now she's getting her life back in order.
Hallelujah.
And I'm sure that she had some good praying parents over her, praying for her. Amen?
Amen. That's right.
How many of you guys pray for your grandkids? Huh? Pray for your kids? Yes. Way to go. That's what we need to do.
I know my parents. My mom was a prayer warrior, and my mother-in-law was a prayer warrior. It's nice to know somebody was praying for you.
Mm-hmm. It surely is.
All the times that you needed prayer. I mean, I need prayer. Not doing right.
Yeah, I had a person send me a scripture, and they sent me a few scriptures here recently, and the first scripture that sent me was the Ephesians, the 6:12, and I'm like, man, I wish I would have had that scripture the day before yesterday. But the truth of the matter is, we do fight the wiles of the enemy.
Yes.
We do fight darkness, and nobody likes to think about that stuff, because they think, oh, there's no devils out there, there's no evil spirits out there. Yeah, there is. But there's also angels out there, mighty warriors of God out there. And we have a right to call them down to help us. I have a painting in the hallway back there of Ephesians 6:12. And it shows all this evil junk behind this warrior. And the warrior is a child of God. We are the warrior. Sometimes we forget who we are because we in our own self feel weak. But we're a warrior. And if you're standing for God, all those things are behind you trying to trip you up. And see, Elijah forgot who he was. He forgot he was a mighty warrior. He forgot he was a prophet of God. And what one of those evil things back there got him. And what was that? I'm all alone. I'm the only one left. Nobody understands. And now they're out to seek my life. Yes?
I kind of wonder, reading that, if he didn't get prideful from taking down the false prophets, and he thought maybe somehow it was because of him that it happened. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, he called God down, but being that happened right after that, all of a sudden, how could you possibly be afraid when Jezebel threatens you? You know, it's like, if you understood.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, so I'm thinking because of the great act of God that he was involved with, he got prideful.
Yeah,
then he started depending on himself again instead of God. So because I've seen ministers do the same thing.
Yes.
Something, they do something, and then all of a sudden they're mighty because they've been able to, you know, do certain things, missions, or, you know, help them, and then all of a sudden something comes up against them and they fall apart. It's like, don't you remember who made it all possible? It wasn't
God.
You.
Yeah.
Yeah, it wasn't you, it was God.
It was God, yeah.
I think we got to raise up ministries because the evil one is after them more than anybody.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
They're under attack more than anybody.
Yeah, they are. But love conquers all. That's what scripture says.
Prophet passions.
Mm-hmm.
In 2002, my mom passed away and I was with her.
Mm-hmm.
And earlier, she had been battling cancer for 3 years. And I just had to make sure that I knew mom and dad wouldn't go to heaven. So we talked about that. I mean, I was raised in church. Mom, dad took us, everything else. So I was with mom. Mm-hmm. And she wanted a drink, so I got her a drink. And she kept saying, I see the lights. She would reach up. And I said, well, now I have either dust it on light, mom, on the bottom. No, she said, lights. And then when she took her last, right before she took her last breath, she said, oh, mom, and reached up. And I know she saw the glory of God.
Yeah.
I know.
My mom, I keep saying this over and over, but when she took her last breath, she looked straight up and just tears came in her eyes. And I knew she was seeing some. And, you know, I sang Jesus Loves You in her ear because I sang it to my dad. And, we don't know what they're seeing. We don't know what they're going through. The only time we're going to know is when we receive it ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
But I do know this. There are mighty angels out there, spirits of God, that can protect us and can help us walk through any battle if we call them.
Mm-hmm.
We've got to ask for God's help. We've got to seek Him and get out of ourselves. And for any of us, our families, and for this church. This church needs to get out of itself. You know, we need to have outreach. We need to get people in here. And it's not to grow the church. It's to know, allow God to touch their hearts.
Yeah, that's God in us. But, you know, that's what, you know, God's been showing me. I know you weren't here 2 weeks when I preached on it, last week when I preached on it, but the battle we're fighting is a spiritual battle, and you can't fight it in the flesh. You have to fall back on God's word. You have to have faith in it, which is what the Bible tells us. But you also have to speak it out. And like you say, we have to reach out with God's love to others, you know. And so many times, people want to try to fight it in the physical realm, and you can't fight the spiritual realm in the physical realm.
You have to see it through God's eyes. I want to tell you a little story. You know, well, before I tell you the story, I want to share that we've got a bonfire in heaven. I remember in the old days, people coming to the altar and praying until they got release. Until God touched them and gave them peace over it. Mm-hmm. Why don't we see that anymore? I can do it right here in my seat. You know? And yeah, you can. But sometimes there's nothing wrong with a good old-fashioned praying at the altar or falling on your face before God. I want to tell you a little story about this little kid and his mom. This little kid was looking at his mom, and all of a sudden he's like, and she said, "Well, what are you looking at? What's wrong?" And he says, "Mommy, I can see myself in your eyes." And she said, "Oh, really? Well, what do you see?" And he looked harder and he says, "I see a lion." You know, if we look hard enough for God, we're going to see his reflection in us. Right? We look hard enough for him and what he wants of us, we're going to see his reflection in us. Do you understand what I'm saying? Seek him. Run after him. He's running after you. And he's like, "I want to get you." It's like chasing your little kid down when they get lost, you know, or something, or when they want to go see something, and you're like, no, because they might run out and get hit by a car or something like that, and you're chasing after them. You're like, "Come here, stop," and they're still running. God's chasing after us, so we need to turn around and chase after him, and we'll have a collision with the Almighty God. And we'll see his glory come down. And we'll see the anointing of the Holy Ghost pour out. Uh-huh. Amen? Amen. Let's close now. Father, I thank you for this word, Lord. I pray that it touched hearts, Father God. And Lord, I ask for blessings for each and every one. I ask that you go with them to their homes, to their jobs, to their families, that your face would shine upon them, Lord. In Jesus' precious name. Amen and amen. Amen. God bless you. Keep coming back. God's works. Glad to see Joanne back. We missed her.
Glad to be better.